Heavenly Father, we thank you for our Bible study. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for bringing us here today. Thank you for all the locations where we have the Bible study. And thank you because your people have come with hearts open to receive from you. And we pray that nobody will be disappointed in Jesus' name. We're just praying, Lord, that your hand will be upon every one of us. That we have proper understanding of your word, even tonight in Jesus' name. And we pray that this word will strengthen us and prepare us for the challenges ahead of us in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, as we're eager to learn, eager to know, we pray, Lord, we'll be as eager to practice the word you're teaching us every time in Jesus' name. Help us, Lord, to keep on standing on this word of truth, the word of life that you are teaching us. That, Lord, our profiting in the word will be known to everybody around us in Jesus' name. Amen. Strengthen your people tonight. Amen. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Thank you very much. You can be seated. We come to our Bible study once again tonight. And we're looking at Matthew chapter 5. In Matthew chapter 5, we're actually looking at it from verse 9 all through to verse 12. Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. We're still in the Beatitudes. And in the Beatitudes, we're looking at these verses of scriptures today. I want to remind you once again that these are the very words of the Lord Jesus Christ. He has been telling us and painting the picture of the blessed man, the blessed woman, that is the believer, the child of God, for us. And as he traces the path of blessedness, he has told us, number one, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Actually, that's where to start. You cannot jump the fence and come out, just say, blessed are the peacemakers. You're going to have a wrong idea, a false idea, who those peacemakers are, if you don't start from verse 3. But you see, when you start from verse 3, first of all, you come into the kingdom. And as you come into the kingdom, you know that he's talking to citizens of the kingdom. How do you become a citizen of the kingdom? You realize you're a sinner. You repent of your sins. And then you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, because he came to take away our sins. Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Because of that, you now have a name, that is, you're a citizen of the kingdom of God. And then he says, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. After you are born again, it's possible that you might be surprised that there's temptation. And then in that temptation, if you happen to fall to such temptation, what you'll do is to mourn for your sin and to mourn for your carelessness. Because of that mourning, you're sorry for what you have done. You go back to the cleansing blood of the Lamb again, and it cleanses you all over again. In that cleansing, there is comfort. It comforts you because now you receive that forgiveness again, that pardon again, that grace again, that reunion with the Lord again, and with the reunited fellowship with the Lord. Now you rejoice in the comfort of the pardon, of the forgiveness of the Lord. But not only that, you mourn for your mistake, mourn for your foolishness, mourn for your carelessness, and mourn for your sin if you happen to sin. And then you get forgiveness. You mourn for the sins of other people. As you look all around you and you see the wickedness of man, and the hatred of man, and the foolishness of man, and the rejection of Christ, then you mourn because of that. In that mourning, you don't lock yourself and just say you are mourning. You go out and you talk to the people that are kneeling Christ on the cross again. And then as they are being converted and the Lord is answering your prayer, then you are rejoicing, because in the conversion of the people you are praying for, you are being comforted. And then it goes on to say, blessed are the meek. Remember, you are poor in spirit. And remember, you mourn for sin. And remember now, after all that has been done, you are meek, you are lowly, you are gentle. These are the characteristics and the qualities of the people in the kingdom. It says, for they shall inherit the earth. Then it says, blessed are they which do thirst, hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. That means then, after you are born again, you'll not just rest satisfied, folding your hand, I've got it all because I got saved. You know, brothers and sisters, there are many people in this world, in fact, in the church world, that feel that after you are saved, you have got it all. They know nothing about the righteousness of God, about the purity of heart, about the holiness experience, or about sanctification. They feel, I'm saved, I'm saved, I'm through. I've got everything I will ever get. But the Lord is saying, after you've got the initial experience, and you're born again, you are washed in the blood of the Lamb, and there's a joy of salvation in your heart, then you are still panting, you are longing, you are desiring, and you are thirsty and hungry for that righteousness which is of God. That's why it says, blessed are they which do thirst, which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. And then, blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the merciful. You know the tendency after you are saved, after you have been purified, and now you are living the righteous life by the grace of God, it's likely that you become impatient with the people who are not running as fast as you are running, with the people who are not reading the Bible, who do not understand the word of God as much as you understand the word of God. And therefore, because of that tendency, that's what the Lord is telling us. Are you saved? Praise the Lord. And are you sanctified? Praise the Lord. Have you been filled with the righteousness of God? Praise the Lord. But don't forget, blessed are the meek. In the experiences you have, you say, become patient, humble, lowly, and meek with other people. That's why it says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. And then blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. I pray we'll see God. But you know, if we're going to see God here today, and we're going to see God in eternity, it takes purity of heart. It takes that experience of sanctification. That's why the Bible says, follow peace with all men, and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. Now, after all those wonderful experiences, he now tells us something very important in verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. You see, these qualities we have, they are the things that mark out the children of God. How do you know a child of God? Because anybody can just rise up and say, I'm a child of God. I'm born again. And I have Christ living inside me. How can you prove that it's right? Because you cannot see inside him. How can you prove that he's wrong? Because you cannot see whether he has Christ in him or not. But this is the practical thing that is very evident. Blessed are the peacemakers, because they shall be called the children of God. You can tell whether he's a peace-loving child of God, whether he's a peace-making child of God, or whether he loves conflict. And if he loves conflict, you know who he's related with, because Christ is the Prince of Peace. And if he, on the other hand, he loves conflict and fighting and hatred and violence, and he has practiced boxing, and he puts that boxing into practice, and he knocks everybody down whenever they disagree with him, you can tell who he's related with. But if we're children of God, it says this is the evidence, and this is the visible thing we can see. Blessed are the peacemakers, because they shall be called the children of God. And then he tells us, even after you have been a peacemaker, you know, there are many people that think, if I am very nice and I'm very good and I have the fruit of the Spirit, the love and the joy and the peace and the patience, that's long suffering, and the gentleness and the meekness and the faithfulness, if I have those qualities of the fruit of the Spirit, then everybody is going to accept me. Everybody is going to love me. Well, but you need to ask yourself a question. Didn't Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, the one who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, didn't he have all those qualities of love, of joy, of peace, of long-suffering, of meekness, of gentleness, of faithfulness? Of course, he had the qualities. Did they all love him? Did they all accept him? And did they all respect him? Of course, no. That means then, even though we may have all these qualities of character, and we may have the evidence of grace in our lives, that does not mean that everybody in the world is going to accept you, appreciate you, have affection for you. And you think about all the people in the Word of God, John the Beloved. You know, children love one another. And he is the one that told us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He spoke about love and love and love every time. You are going to see anybody talking about love every time, demonstrating that love every time, everybody will rally around him like the flies run after the honey. But not like that. You remember that John the Beloved was put in a boiling oil, in a pot of boiling oil. Why? Because there's persecution. Persecution for the righteous. Persecution for the children of God. That's why Jesus Christ said, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Oh, you see, if you know, if they are being persecuted, maybe there's something wrong in their lives. Maybe they are not actually practicing that word of God the way they ought to practice. Jesus said, no, for the righteousness that they manifest, and for the life of purity, for the life of holiness, they demonstrate. That's the reason why they are being persecuted. It says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Then it says, blessed are ye when men shall revile you. Now, it says you are persecuted in verse 10, and it says in verse 11, you are reviled. That means they'll belittle you, they will insult you, they'll cast aspersions on you, they'll call you nicknames, bad names, that will be very, very painful. That's reviling. They'll abuse you, they'll insult you, that's a persecution. And it says, you are blessed when they do that, and they persecute you, and it shall say all manner of evil against you falsely. Do you know anybody who has run away from the church because, you know, somebody told lies against him, and he said something false about him, and he said, me, I'm a child of God, I am righteous, I'm this, I'm that, and they could tell such lies against me, all right, there's no point anymore living a righteous life. If I have done the best I could do, and they still tell these lies against me, no way, I'm not going to remain a Christian anymore. They didn't read their Bibles. Because Jesus said, blessed are you when they shall say all manner of evil against you for my sake. Then he said, rejoice. It is a cry. He said, rejoice. It is a give up. He said, rejoice. It is a get discouraged. He said, rejoice. He didn't say, abandon the faith. He said, when you are persecuted like that, and your righteousness is called to question, and your stand for the Lord is called to question. He said, rejoice. Then he tells us why we're to rejoice. In fact, he said, be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. I pray God will reward you. Amen. But you know, if you are persecuted, and then you run away from the church, where's the reward? How are you going to get the reward? If you are persecuted and you abandon the faith, are you going to be rewarded? If a little insult, a little abuse, a little opposition, a little persecution makes you crumble, and then you are discouraged, and then there is no faith anymore, how are you going to get your reward? That's exactly what the devil wants to do. After you have gone through quite a lot in your life, after you have endured quite a lot in your life, the devil wants you to give up, but you will not give up. I said you will not give up, because it says, great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. You are in good company when they persecute you, because you are just counted like those prophets of old. I divide the message into three parts. Number one, the practice of peace making children of God. The practice. of peacemaking children of God. Number two, the persecution of peaceful children of God. The persecution of peaceful children of God. Number three, the prophet of persecuted children of God. The prophet of persecuted children of God. Let's come to number one, the practice of peacemaking children of God. Let's look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. He says, blessed. That word blessed, I'm sure you know. It means happy. It means fortunate. It means favored. Favored, fortunate, happy, blessed are the peacemakers, because they shall be called the children of God. The true child of God is a peacemaker. Check up your own life. The true child of God is a peacemaker. Anywhere you see conflict, anywhere you see disunity, anywhere you see discord, anywhere you see contention, anywhere you see problem, if you have the nature of Christ in you, you want to be a problem solver. And as you think about it, the privilege, the opportunity of solving problems, that you will find everywhere. And people have problems. Problems in relationship. You know, men have problems with God because they're sinners. And they turn their backs against God. And you're reconciling God with man, or man with God, because you're a peacemaker. And there are families, there are problems there. You have husband and wife, there are problems, challenges, and they turn their backs at one another. If you're a peacemaker, you'll be reconciling the husband with the wife. Parents and children, there are times there are problems, and the parents say, I don't want to see that child, not in this house anymore. And the child is throwing stones back to the house. And if you are a child of God, what are you doing? You are making peace between them, reconciling the children with the parents. In-laws have problems with their son-in-law, daughter-in-law. If you're a child of God, the opportunity is there every time. And landlords have problems with their tenants. And if you're a child of God, you are not increasing the problem. You are not contributing to the problem. You are contributing to the solution, because it says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. A child of God will love peace, will desire peace, will promote peace, will work for peace, will pray for peace, and it will do everything to maintain peace among men. Actually, if you're a real child of God, you hate discord. You detest it. You abhor it, and you shun it at all costs, and you hate anything that will bring discord or division among the people of God. Real children of God will labor with all their might to prevent the fire of contention from being kindled. And where that fire is already kindled, you will do everything you can to calm the stormy spirits of men, and to quieten the turbulent passion, and soften the minds of contending parties, and reconcile people one to another. Because of the importance of this section, let me just go through one by one. Number one, the model for peacemakers, because it says, blessed are the peacemakers. Can we point to the model? And then we can say, if I'm going to be a peacemaker, here is my model. And here is the example that I'm to follow. Number one, then, the model for peacemakers in Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. I'm reading to you from verse 20. Colossians chapter 1, verse 20. Here it says, and having made peace, peacemakers. Who are peacemakers? The peacemakers are those who make peace. And here we're told of Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, our model in peacemaking. It says, and having made peace through the blood of his cross. We learn something here. It takes sacrifice to make peace. It takes sacrifice to make peace. If you are not willing to sacrifice anything from yourself, even your very blood, you cannot be a peacemaker. And if you are full of self, and full of vainglory, and full of whatever you want, and full of whatever you desire, and full of wanting recognition, and full of wanting the praise of men, you'll never be a peacemaker. You see, the model for peacemakers. The Lord Jesus Christ, we're told, he made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself. By him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. And you will see who that was sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked words, yet now are still reconciled. Who are we reconciling? Are we reconciling friends that have no problems together? Of course no. We're reconciling people that have problems with one another. They are alienated from one another. They are enemies to one another. Those are the people we're making the peace for, or making the peace with, in the body of his flesh, through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. It tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 18. In 2 Corinthians 5:18, here is what it says, and all things.